All right. Welcome to my talk about Let's Encrypt in general and specifically on OpenSUSE and why you should, in case you are, no longer be afraid to use it. So before we dive into the topic, let's briefly introduce myself. My name is Daniel Morkentin. I live in Berlin and I work as a Slash core developer at SUSE. I am a bit interested in practical privacy and security, which is why I'm giving this talk and why I also introduced Let's Encrypt into OpenSUSE. And other than that, I'm part of the team that helps making recording of conferences like these. If you saw the description, I said, or the title had the Roadrunner in it, and it's not a project as more as something that gives a theme to the whole thing, and you will later see why. Specifically, I introduced the Roadrunner because you know how it's always, does everyone know the cartoon character in here? Who knows the Roadrunner from Coyote and the Roadrunner? A couple of you, okay. So he's always the lucky guy who's chased by a coyote and he'll survive. He's gonna be fine in the end. And we'll see how this connects, but essentially I've taken this as a sort of a project name for having a real easy, quick, and fast to get running kind of solution for TLS certificates using Let's Encrypt and OpenSUSE. And I really want setting up TLS to be as fast as that Roadrunner is running away from Coyote. So what should you expect from this talk? I want you to show, and I want you to know how to TLS secure, or which services to TLS secure, and essentially, spoiler alert here, like you can essentially now TLS secure any service. The challenges that TLS or deploying TLS brings and how Let's Encrypt helps you solving them. And of course, Let's Encrypt is, you know, that thing that everyone tells you to use now, but how we're going to go. We're going to take a look into that as well. And finally, I'll explain how I think we can still improve in OpenSUSE in making it even easier for you and other users to actually use it. And I hope you can make an informed decision on how to go about TLS deployment. Yeah, and that is the obvious slide that briefly sums up TLS. Used to be called SSL long, long time ago when it was a proprietary standard by drawn up by Netscape. In the meantime, it's an IETF specified standard, and if you check below there, Vitechlav has given a very good talk just, I think, 2 hours ago that is already online, and you should really check out the latest TLS versions, but for now, the version that we support is TLS 1.2, which is an approved IETF standard. And the purpose is to secure existing protocols in transit. So between two ports, you have a TCP connection, and instead of directly sending HTTP, you first establish an SSL connection and then use TCP, SMTP, IMAP, whatever, over that now secure line. And essentially, what makes this work is the chain of trust model. So that means that there is certain entities that in the end you have to trust to make this work. These entities are called certificate authorities, and they have something called root certificates or root anchors And we're going to talk about them later as well. So, fair question, why should you even bother? First of all, the panic has been all around the world, and particularly in Europe, the new data protection laws that essentially say you have to make a realistic effort to secure your data in transit. Then there are certain things, especially if you're dealing with credit card companies, that will make you adhere to certain policies, and they will send auditors to make sure you adhere to them. And again, this may be part of that. Sneaky spies, Snowden, enough said. But really, more realistically, it's these guys. Like sneaky script kiddies spoofing a Wi-Fi. You think, hey, free internet, and there go your data. And this is really the most likely scenario. Even though we all think, well, we need to protect ourselves from the NSA, whatever. Really, in the end, it's these kids. And by the way, whoever comes up with his stock photos, really, no. So, but there is still not an answer to why do we need a free and automatic certificate authority. After all, there is an existing system, right? And to motivate that, first the question, why does your OS or browser trust the certificate authority? Does anyone know? So how come there's this list of certificate authorities in your browser? They declare themselves secure. Well, one answer I would say, the browser or operating vendor vetted them. And that is sort of true, but not really. The better truth is that they are really paying a lot of money to a company. And that's the point. They are paying a company to compile them an audit report. And with that audit report and certain other things, they then go to the browser vendors and say, see, we can be trusted. Maybe a good idea, maybe not. Because there were quite some CAs that were breached, and the most prominent breach is DigiNotar, right? Back in 2011. And then we had the VoScience.com disaster, who actually breached the policies set out by themselves along with browser vendors and other CAs, the so-called CAB forum. And finally, just recently, Symantec with known and really common brands like GeoTrust, Thorti, VeriSign just last year. And over that, they lost all browser trust, and essentially Symantec is now out of the certificate business. For better or worse, probably for better. So yeah, a lot of people need to go somewhere else and dump your money. The question is, do you really need to dump your money somewhere else? Or maybe can you just use Let's Encrypt? And the main argument of the certificate authority, the classic certificate authority, is like, oh no, you know, what we are selling you is identity. Because you can really prove that you are Awesome Incorporated and not just some, you know, weird guy who's trying to steal credit card information or whatever. And the interesting answer is, you may know that if you have these, if you go to some online shops, you have next to the URL bar, you know, trusted web shop incorporated in green letters. So that's supposed to make you feel really safe that you're really talking to that entity. And officially they say, yes, we will check your business, that it really exists, that it is registered, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Unfortunately, it's quite easy to spoof because you can just set up the same company in a different country. That has proven to work. Or you can just, you know, register a company. And again, registering a company is like $1 or something in the worst case. That has ambiguous names like secure.ltd. And everyone was like, oh, cool. There is the word secure in green letters next to the URL bar, so it's really secure now. But that has no meaning. If you do a poll and ask people if they know why exactly there's sometimes a company name in green letters, what that means, and what it, if that's really different trust level to them, you will see that they are utterly confused and they have no idea. Actually, there was a paper, I think 2 or 3 years ago, that did exactly that and tried to poll public opinion about what that actually meant, and the result was quite disastrous. So these so-called extended validation or organization validated certificates, their value is doubtful at best. So Let's Encrypt will not issue any extended validation certificate. They will just issue the main validated certificate, which means they just validate that you control that domain, nothing else. And finally, if you ever bought a traditional certificate, then you would get, if you had a good reseller, then they would give you setup guidance for the most popular web servers or email servers. But it was still a pain making good choices because also these setup guides were sometimes outdated. So making good choices in terms of, you know, what sort of crypto you deploy along with these certificates was really a problem. And every 1 to 4 years you would get something like that because someone else, someone who was in charge in your company of renewing the certificates, forgot at least one host. So, and the solution to that was, okay, next time we are not purchasing the 1 or 2 year certificates, we are purchasing the insanely expensive 4 years experience, which saves you that, which basically means you will get the same embarrassment, only you have 4 years time to prepare for the next time and you won't do it anyway. So, after I hope I made it clear that you don't want traditional certificates anymore, let's now see what Let's Encrypt can do for you and what it actually is. So we've established we needed a new kind of certificate authority, one that is fully automated. And once it's fully automated, the cool thing is that we can actually have reduced certificate lifetime. So it's suddenly completely okay if a certificate is only valid for a couple of weeks. Because it's all automated, right? So what happened is that the Electronic Frontier Foundation, Mozilla, Akamai, Cisco, and others went to found the Internet Security Research Group. It's currently funded through donations from individuals and companies. And this group runs their own root certificate authority. But of course, the problem is, of course, the problem is, how do you get this everywhere, right? I mean, establishing a root CA everywhere, in all browsers, in all operating systems, in Java, in I don't know what, it just takes some time. And it took, I think, Marcus, correct me if I'm wrong, it took us until for 2 or 4 months we have those certificates in now, yeah. So it took us that time and it will take others even longer. So if there are no root CAs from Let's Encrypt, how is that even a real alternative? And it's a real alternative because another CA called I Don't Trust that has been in browsers and operating systems forever has agreed to cross-sign with Let's Encrypt. That means that until the Let's Encrypt certificate authority is everywhere, you can essentially just use that cross-sign. And that means that all certificates are automatically already valid. And at this point, again, most popular browsers have already picked it up. And the way that Let's Encrypt works, I know said there is this legal entity, but I also said it was automated. So what does automated mean? Automated means they established a excuse me, they established a protocol called ACME, the Automatic Certificate Management Environment. And there were two versions of it. The first attempt is now deprecated. The current version is ACME V2. That has actually been submitted to the Internet Engineering Task Force for standardization as an RFC. And it supports wildcard certificates for the first time, which wasn't supported before. There is a server reference implementation that is also currently running at the Internet Research Security Research Group that is called Boulder. And again, you see the pattern. ACME is that company that would send all kinds of gimmicks to Coyote to chase the Roadrunner. And the Boulders were the ones that were usually used to try to kill the Roadrunner. So that's the general pattern. We're in this comic thing. And so you will see that everything, all the software that is there, refers to some characters or some things in Coyote and the Roadrunner. Then there are a couple of client reference implementation. The most popular is CertBot, which is maintained by the Internet Frontier Foundation. It's written in Python. Unfortunately, it's fairly complex, both in packaging and maintenance. So there have been alternative clients, most prominently Dehydrated in Bash, ACME 2 in Go, and ACME 4J in Java. But there's like a lot of more of these tools available that are usually special purpose. How does it actually work? What you do with ACME is you prove possession or ownership of a specific domain or host name. And there are essentially two strategies these days. Either it's HTTP 01, which basically describes a mechanism where you claim, hey, I own this host, and then the ACME server on the other side basically says, okay, prove it to me. Here's your challenge. If I find that challenge on a specific subdirectory of your web server on port 80, then I genuinely believe that you are in control of that domain name. And the other alternative is DNS01, where the assumption generally is that you could also, as means of proving control, provide that proof, that token, and a TXT record in the DNS zone. So both is possible. If you, however, want wildcard certificates, you must choose DNS01, and we'll later see examples of that. So how did we approach that in starting Leap 15? We adopted Dehydrated, actually. So that's the Bash-based implementation. The good thing is it has very few dependencies that can be relied upon because they're just always there. It's flexible and extendable, so you can write hooks and you can use shell for that and from shell call anything else. And again, we'll see examples of that a bit later. And there is an extensive set of examples and integrations both in the documentation that we ship and on the website of Dehydrated. In addition, we've tried to come up with a really good package. That means we added sub-packages that add integration for Apache, Lighty, and Nginx. We provide cron scripts for older distributions and system D timer for newer. We also provide post-run hooks that are executed as the root user. So usually everything is of course run as a separate user, but if there are things you need to do, like restarting a service or something, then you don't need to do any fancy sudo elevation. You can just do it in a post hook. And then there is a config-d directory scheme where you can overwrite the default config file without ever really touching it. Okay, so let's see how you can actually do this. So assuming a normal Apache setup, you just install Apache Dehydrated and Dehydrated Apache 2. You register a contact because you need to create it's called an account, but what it really is you get a key, and if you register for that key that identifies you, you can optionally provide an email address. You don't have to, but the benefit is that should your automation ever go wrong and Let's Encrypt doesn't receive an attempt to update the certificate or retrieve a new certificate in a certain time, it will warn you that you haven't done so, and then you can check your infrastructure before things go bad. So you should always specify a contact email. Then you claim your host name, or your, and then you run Dehydrated for the first time. Again, you can just call the cron parameter because Dehydrated is going to check if you're running as root. If you're running as root, it will demote itself to the Dehydrated user. And if you successfully retrieved your certificate, then you can enable the Dehydrated timer or make sure that the cron job even runs by default. And now the only task that is still up to you is you yourself have to go to this fancy page here, unless you know. I can show you right here. This page essentially gives you guidance on how to configure your virtual host in Apache in a compatible way. Because again, none of you are probably specialists in that field. If you are, good for you, but most are not. And you can actually tell it, okay, I want to be really secure, I want modern, or I want to be compatible, but not maybe provide support for slightly unsafe mechanisms. Or you can say, okay, I'm running in a legacy environment and I have to be compatible. Then you can choose old. And then you can choose your web server and you're done. Okay, let's switch back. So what does this package do? This Dehydrated Apache 2, it basically creates a file in conf.d that registers a .wellknown. .wellknown is, by the way, RFC specified place for such things, / ACME challenge, and that's actually where the certificate authority of Let's Encrypt will actually assume to find your challenge. And that's just being mapped to varlib Acme Challenge, just to have a local point of storage. So now the more complex is scenario, because you're likely, if you're just your typical home sysadmin, this will probably be enough. But if you have really complex environment with multiple servers, or assume, you know, like cloud services, whatever, then you will probably need a couple of certificates for a couple of host names. So what do you do? This is like the primary case for the DNS method. So what you do is you create a host that is dedicated to actually acquiring certificates. And you add all the certificates that you want to obtain, and you run this. And I'm actually going to show you the configuration for this in a slide later. And then you distribute the certificates to all the hosts that you need, with SSH, with SALT, with whatever. So this is basically basically using sort of an intermediary host on your local end to distribute all the certificates. And this is basically how it looks. You need access to your DNS server. Maybe you can use NS Update. If you can't, there are also scripts available for the most popular DNS providers, because they usually have an API. And what this does is essentially it provides a challenge. And after the CA has successfully validated this challenge, it will remove the challenge from DNS again. And yes, that means that this dedicated host will need to have access to your DNS. And this is why you should compartmentalize this functionality in a single host and not have every host do that, because you probably don't want every host to have access to your DNS infrastructure. And the cool thing about this is that now you may know your intranet, your LAN is probably the way to see that there is an intranet, is because if you visit it with non-company servers, it's the only service that will give you certificate errors all over, because you maybe need to deploy a local CA, or because you're not deploying a CA at all and run with the default certificate, so it will throw an error anyway. And now you don't have to put up with this anymore, because this zone itself needs to be visible to the outside, but you can use internal addresses, whatever you like. It doesn't really matter. So, but now you can acquire you can automatically obtain certificates for devices in your local LAN and distribute them, even to things like LOMs or whatever. And this, if done right, makes your intranet as secure as your ordinary website in terms of transport security and validation safety. The only warning is you should be aware that every certificate, so it doesn't matter if you use Let's Encrypt or any other commercial certificate authority, there is a new policy in place that every certificate needs to be publicly locked. This is a process called certificate transparency. And that means you're leaking the names of your host names to the public. If you're not confident with that, if you're not happy with that, if you are afraid that security through obscurity may be a good idea, which maybe in this case it is, if you don't give external potential attackers too many hints on your internal infrastructure. I mean, there's a reason why you're probably not allowing everyone a zone transfer and DNS right away. And this is a bit like a zone transfer, then you may consider only requesting wildcard certificates and distributing these. Again, this is up to you. And does this work? And the good thing is, yes, it's proven to work because we've rolled this out, like exactly this scenario, or pretty much the scenario, a bit more complex, on OpenSUSE. And I'd like to give a big hand to the OpenSUSE Heroes team. Can we have a big hand, please? Thank you. Because they made sure this actually works. I could only test small things, but they have an entire infrastructure to throw these things on. And Darex especially beta tested the packages and gave me a lot of advice. So this is really cool. So I can confidently say we have at least one infrastructure where this is known to work that is non-trivial. So thank you. Yeah, the future. We've now improved, but it's still, like, for just one server, it's still fairly complicated, right? Because ideally what you want is just to receive a certificate. You don't want to care. And there's two things that I had in mind. The first was a YUST module that I started with together with Klaas in the Hack Week last year. But people convinced me that this may not actually be of much help, because ultimately most people would deploy it through Salt and other things anyway. And in the end, we decided to put it aside and first concentrate on the CLI user experience. If you have a different opinion, you can come to me later on and we can talk about it. It still exists. Then integrated renewal. This is what you really want. There is ModMD in Apache for the trivial cases in particular, where you just create a virtual host, you just say SSL engine on and bam. You don't have to care about the rest. The rest is all taken care of in ModMD. You can tweak a couple of things, like how modern your set of your set of crypto should be, but in general, it's your ciphers and everything. But in general, there is nothing more than to say SSL engine on, and it will deal with the rest. And the problem is, it's there since I think 2.4.30, which means it would be in the code base that is also in lib15. But it's not enabled, and I suppose, I haven't spoken to the maintainer yet, but I suppose that's because the upstream documentation says in big letters it's experimental and ACME 1 only. So I think it's the future, but it's not there yet. There are similar limited features available for self-renewal, for HA proxy and Nginx. And if you prefer to use Go, there is Kedi and there's Traffic, both of which are web servers written in Go that contain ACME-based certificate issuance as an integral part. So that pretty much brings me to the end. So I hope you've seen that you can reliably and automatically obtain and distribute SSL certificates. It's still not easy enough. I'm still not happy, so the Roadrunner can still run faster. And at this point, I really depend and would appreciate your feedback and your contribution. Here is the repository in OBS to dehydrate it. And yeah, please feed the Roadrunner. I'd be really glad if we could have a chat in the end. And if you have any question, here's your time. Thank you.